Betrothals in the past had been announced in church, but by the 1860s, couples had begun announcing their engagements in local newspapers and by writing letters to family and friends. Women also wore engagement rings, a tradition that had begun in the 1840s. Oh, hello, and welcome to Virginia Time Travel, your portal to the Commonwealth's past, present, and future. When we think of love and marriage, it's certainly something that many women themselves have been dreaming about since they were little girls. For men, something they've probably been dreaming about since, well, the day before the wedding, let's be fair. However, no matter how we think of love and affection and marriages itself, since the days of the Civil War, things have certainly started to take a life of its own, one where dreams, reality, fantasy, and reality, all of this comes together and merges. And so when we look at the Civil War wedding, we have to start off at the most simple point, that of the engagement. While love and affection counted for much in tying the marriage knot, wary parents still considered a suitor's ability to support their daughter. This was especially important since a married woman was both legally and financially dependent on her husband. Women usually married in their late teens or early 20s. Men were usually at least 8 years older, as befitted their role as good providers. Now, the dynamics of courtship and engagement changed with the coming of the Civil War. Social activities decreased, and the number of the eligible men, especially in the South, significantly decreased. Esther Allen expressed the attitude of young women in the South as the war progressed by saying, quote, "One looks at a man so differently when you think he may be killed tomorrow. Men whom up to this time I had thought dull and commonplace seemed charming." The famous diarist Mary Chestnut of South Carolina was appalled when she saw women of her own class flirting openly with strangers in public. After traveling from Richmond to the Carolinas on the train, Chestnut was horrified at the displays of affection she witnessed. She said, quote, "I wish I might never have known of girls who kissed the back of horrid men's necks." Chestnut, like most older women, deplored the headlong rush to the altar and hurried courtships of the war years. The diaries of hundreds of women of the time attest to the marrying craze that swept the South. "Every girl in Richmond is engaged or about to be," wrote Phoebe Pember Yates in February of 1864. Fear of spinsterhood and natural desire, heightened by the immediacy of war, led to many unconventional matches, many reflecting the truth of a phrase common to the time: "The blockade don't keep out babies." Now, things in the North were somewhat better, but single men were still scarce. Mary Livermore wrote, "Wisconsin and Iowa are run by women. Women were doing jobs previously performed by men. Women were in the fields, behind store counters, and manning factories. Recuperating soldiers were eagerly sought after." But when it comes to the wedding, we have to think of clothes. And over the centuries, brides continued to dress in a manner befitting their social status, always in the height of fashion, with the richest, boldest materials money could buy. The poorest of brides wore their best church dress on their wedding day. The amount of material a wedding dress contained also was a reflection of the bride's social standing and indicated the extent of the family's wealth to wedding guests. Brides have not always been known to wear white, though, for the marriage ceremony. In the 16th and 17th centuries, for example, girls in their teens married in a pale green, a sign of fertility. A mature girl in her 20s wore a brown dress, and older women even wore black. White did not become a popular option, however, until 1840, after the marriage of Queen Victoria to Prince Albert of Saxe-Coburg-Gotha. Victoria wore a white gown for the event in order to incorporate lace she owned that had special sentimental value. The royal wedding portrait photograph was widely published, and many other brides opted for a similar dress. The tradition continues today in the form of a white wedding, though prior to the Victorian era, a young bride was married in any color except black, the color of mourning, or red, which was connected with prostitutes. Queen Victoria was not the first royal bride, however, to wear a white wedding gown, but the first of the modern era. White had been a traditional color of royal mourning, and although not often utilized as such, white was not considered a suitable choice for a royal wedding. Victoria's choice popularized the white gown, as no other had been before her. Previously, brides wore their best clothes or the most expensive new clothes they could afford. But formal weddings during this period were all white, including the bridesmaids' dresses and veils. After Queen Victoria popularized the Mediterranean custom of wearing orange blossoms, symbolic of fertility, everyone began doing it. Sometimes brides would even fasten garlands of orange blossoms to their dresses. Brides in the northern states often used wax copies, since orange blossoms could not survive transport to cooler climates. Weddings were welcome social events during the war, and even threadbare brides were radiant. Economy usually replaced the glorious wedding gowns of the past, and a nice day dress was considered proper attire. But flowers, especially orange blossoms, were still seen. Northerner Ellen Wright wrote that she was going to renovate her old clothes for her wedding because she had no interest in, quote, shining forth in new apparel in these hard times, end quote. Now, when we think of weddings today, though, there are a number of superstitions that we're all concerned about, and the true could be said back during the Victorian era. For you see, Victorians had superstitions about being lucky in love, even before the engagement was made. Victorian women would reject a suitor whose last name began with the same initial as hers. Hence the saying, to change the name but not the letter is a change for the worse and not the better. If the right suitor was found and the couple became engaged, all sorts of omens were considered for the big day. Wednesday was considered the luckiest day of the week. Monday for wealth, Tuesday for health, Wednesday the best day of all. Thursday for crosses, Friday for losses, Saturday no luck at all. Victorians did hold rehearsals for the nuptial ceremony, much like we do today. However, it was considered bad luck for a bride to participate, so a friend would take her place in the practice session. On the day of the wedding itself, a bride could pick on a bad luck if she looked into a mirror after she was dressed for the ceremony. In order to avoid this, the clever girl left off a glove or a slipper before taking a final peek. As for the ceremony itself, June, named after Juno, the Roman goddess of marriage, has always been the most popular month for weddings, still true even to this date. Juno was said to bring prosperity and happiness to all who wed in her month. In the southern United States, April was the favorite month for the weddings, as it was cooler and a bride's favorite flowers were in bloom, jasmine and camellia. Weddings grew more elaborate as the 19th century progressed. Traditionally, nuptials had been performed in the family parlor and had frequently been civil ceremonies presided over by a local judge or justice of the peace. The Civil War era found more couples being married in churches, at least partly to accommodate larger numbers of guests. When the hour for the ceremony arrived and all things were ready, the wedding party, consisting of the happy couple with the bridesmaids and groomsmen, walked into the room arm in arm, the groomsmen each attending the bridesmaids, preceding the bride and groom, and took its positions at the end of the room farthest from the entrance.